should feature living artists. And I think one of the interesting things about Biennale is that they happen like clockwork every 2 years. They're very engaged in history, and we offer artists the opportunity to reflect on what's happening in that period, their time. And they offer audiences every 2 years this amazing opportunity to have this conversation with groups of artists from all over the world, reflecting on this culture that we all live and seeing it from different angles, of course, because in different parts of the world things are different. Looking at this particular time that we did it, it seemed to me that it was marked by increasingly strong divisions of different kinds. We all know that the question of national borders and boundaries has been a major issue for several years. Tensions caused by immigration, by refugees. We also live in a moment that may be the moment where there is the greatest inequality of wealth that there has been for the last 200 years. And there has been an enormous division created by those who have this wealth and the rest of us. We've also seen a strange division that I don't think many people anticipated that has emerged through the things that the internet has made possible, particularly social media. So, Paolo Baratta spoke very eloquently about this idea of openness. And I have to say that one of my inspirations for this Biennale has been an amazing text by Umberto Eco, The Open Work, as it's known in English, which is almost 60 years old. And if you read it, to me it still seems a completely accurate description. And he really talks about what is valuable art is its relentless questioning, its relentless innovation, its open-ended thinking, its ability to dwell in ambiguity and ambivalence, to deal with paradox and contradiction, to be complex, and to find in the noise of information in the world new signals that we can give meaning to. So in an age of Twitter, when communication is getting reduced to simpler fragments, in an age when we have social media news feeds where your information is tailored according to your likes and dislikes, your biases, so rather than being exposed to more information, you actually are getting less information. Our political discourses are becoming narrower and narrower so that people on opposite sides can't even speak to each other anymore. They didn't have a common language. So somehow, when the internet was born, it had this amazing promise of making free circulation of information. And we've also seen how it's made possible the free circulation of disinformation and misinformation. We've seen how this has been used to try to affect elections, not only in the United States, but also in the UK, the whole Brexit election. So there are these very profound divisions that we face. And to me, in this moment, that power of art, the kinds of things that Umberto Eco spoke about, makes art, and I think it really a unique cultural area, territory, arena, where complexity is valued and treasured, and where we're asked to think in ways that reflect how complex we actually are as human beings. I think, you know, it's against the idea of formulas and mindless following of conventions, conformism. This is what art, this is how art engages us. So this idea of being live in interesting times, and I think we always are living in interesting times. And I've gone back and read press releases from many different Biennales. Half of the press releases I've read, for the first 3 pages, you don't even know it's an art exhibition, because they're just talking about how what catastrophe the state of world affairs is in. So I think this feeling that now we're living in a crisis is the one that's often with us. This particular title shows, because of its very strange history, it's a phrase that's been discussed and referred to as if it was an ancient Chinese curse. And this began in the 1930s with a British politician, Austen Chamberlain. His brother-in-law was prime minister. It's continued through writers like Albert Camus, the French novelist, Arthur C. Clarke, the British famous science fiction writer, Robert Kennedy, the American politician, more recently Hillary Rodham Clinton, all have written books referring to this ancient Chinese curse. And it turns out there is no such ancient Chinese curse. Someone made this up. But this made-up proverb, this made-up cultural artifact, has ended up having a real impact in the world through this, the way it's been used in this discourse. So fake news, unfortunately, has real consequences. And this very complicated relationship, I think, is a very interesting one to see how the work of artists might shed light on this. Artists, I mean, there's a famous phrase that one of Trump's consultants came up with, alternative facts. What's an alternative fact, right? A fact is something we agree is true. Can there be an alternative truth? No, you can have an alternative point of view. Artists deal in alternative perspectives and alternative points of view. So in putting this exhibition together, I wanted to celebrate that very particular aspect of contemporary art. And I didn't really want to have a theme. There are over 300 biennials in the world today. They all have themes, but they almost always have the same format. And I think we needed to have more experimentation in terms of the format of an exhibition. I'm also not a big fan of the idea that the curator has a great thesis which the exhibition somehow illustrates. To me, the exhibition is the provocation that allows the audience to develop the theories. Because art is very much about having a conversation with people. It's open. That's one of its great qualities. It doesn't resolve things. So to celebrate this idea of the alternative perspectives, this year's Biennale actually is divided in two. There are two sections. There's a Proposition A and a Proposition B. Proposition A will be in the Arsenale, Proposition B in the Giardini in the Central Pavilion. These exhibitions will be quite different in atmosphere in terms of the artworks they have. And yet, strangely enough, they'll feature the same list of artists. So all the same artists will show in both places, but they will show work that's completely different. Because besides making individual artworks that are multivalent and complex, artists also have practices that have many different aspects and sides and dimensions to them. And I wanted this exhibition to make that very clear, that just because you see one work by an artist, you may not really know what their practice is. So now at least you'll see two very different works. And it's my hope that for those people who don't like to read wall labels or texts on the walls with people's names on them, you could go through these two exhibitions and you would have no idea that they were made by the same group of artists. At the same time, there are several leitmotifs rather than themes that came up in the course of putting the exhibition together. And they do concern subjects like walls, boundaries and borders, alternative realities and parallel worlds of different kinds, split identities, alternative identities. So this notion of two things side by side, I think it's very interesting. There's a book, a novel by a British science fiction writer named China Melville called The City in the City. And it's about set in a kind of Eastern European, post-Soviet milieu, two cities occupy the exact same footprint. But the governments of each city forbid their citizens to acknowledge the existence of the other inhabitants. So they live side by side, but they learn to unsee the people from the other city. And in some ways, this is a very strong metaphor for what we all do every day in the cities we live in. There are lots of things we just ignore, we don't want to look at. And so denial can also create a form of division. We can just not see things. And there are some works in the exhibition that also explore that idea. Sometimes we live in two different worlds because we refuse to look at the world we live in. So I'm going to show you some images of some works in the exhibition. As has always been the case in the past, in the Venice Biennale, there are going to be many new works that artists are making. I wish I could show you those, but in many cases, they're not finished. So I'm going to show you some of the existing works that will be in the exhibition.